glorious God, King, wonderful is the name of our memory, name, Jesus, 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 Redeemer, Savior, friend, Jesus, 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 Redeemer. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Blessed is the name of the Lord our God. Lord, we praise you. Blessed is the name of the Lord our God, and we worship you. Lord, we worship you. I want you to think about for just a minute, think about the happiest you've ever been, the most excited you've ever been. And I want you to just recognize, label that your emotions. And I want you to think about the fact of it is that the best things that you know about life is something that comes out of your emotions. Best things. And the worst things that you know is about life comes out of your emotions. There it is. Hello. Fathers, listen to me. Listen to me. Because this is something that it's somewhat of a challenge for God's people to understand this, for people in general to understand this. But God's looking for us to simply allow him so much place in our life. He just wants us to come to a place where we will yield to him and allow him so much place in our life that out of our emotions begin to be floods of that which he's feeling right now. His emotions. Holy emotions. I'm telling you right now, if you walked around in joy unspeakable and full of glory, you would have an abundant life. Let me just say this. If you walked around with joy unspeakable and full of glory, gushing out of you, just so happy and so thankful, you would love everybody. You'd be happy with everything going on. You'd be one person totally detached from all the other stuff. Because I'm going to tell you right now, all the other stuff, you're trying to get happy from it. You're trying to keep sad away. The job, the money, the reputation, everything. Just, I want you to, you may not understand what I'm saying right now, but you just go home and analyze it a little while. You go home and think about it just a little bit deeper. What on earth compels you to do all the stuff you've been doing? What on earth is the motivator behind all the stuff that you've been doing? You're just going to have to think about it for a while. I've thought about it quite a bit. And then I looked at the Word of God and I saw Father describing to us really everything that is going to bring all that he has for us into our life, so that we can experience this life of God. Jesus Christ came and died 2,000 years ago. He came, was born of a virgin, born of a woman who never knew a man, incarnated from heaven, the eternal Word of God, the eternal Word, God. We call him the Word because he's the definition of God. He's the revelation of God. He's the proclamation of God. He's the definition of God. He's everything that God has ever spoken, all wrapped up in one single person. And he, because he loved humanity so much, because he loved me so much, because he loved you so much, left all of his riches and took upon himself the form of a sinful man, became poor for our sakes, so that we could be made richly supplied with the kind of life that he's living. Man disobeyed God, rebelled against God, and stepped into every unholy emotion, everything that belongs to death, everything that belongs to sorrow, sadness, sighing. Everything that belongs to hate and envy and strife and discouragement and disappointment and condemnation and fear and shame. And people are stuck in that. And here's what God asks. Here's the big thing God asks of you. Stop that. This is the big thing that God asks. He's just asking. He says, will you just come and receive my life? I made a way for you to have my life. Here's Father's is asking his declaration to us. And then men come along with all of their crazy ideas and people live under the bondage of the most crazy theories, speculative theories that anyone's ever come up with, that in the same audience and in the same company you're supposed to be able to show reproducible proofs for everything that you believe, and yet the very foundation of the things that they want to espouse has no reproducible evidence at all. that any of their ideas are right, and men become willing to be subjugated and brought into bondage with that, just to be sadder, more fearful, more full of shame, more discouraged, more disappointed. And tonight, Father's inviting you, come on in and have some fellowship with Him. He's inviting you to forget all the other stuff, lay it aside, and come and respond to an open door that's set before you right now. Christ Jesus, He died that you and I might have this abundant life and be blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. You can be seated. Why not just take Him up on it? Why not just take Him up on it? Somebody said, well, you don't know what's going on in my house. You don't know what's going on in my life. You don't know the disappointments that I've encountered. You don't know all the things that I imagine on a daily basis and all the stuff that goes through my mind. You don't know all the questions and issues that I deal with. Forget about it. What good has that done you? I mean, if it's doing you some good, hang on to it. Come on. But if it's not doing you any good, throw it away. It's trash. Are you listening to me? If it's just nothing but a burden around your neck, why don't you just go ahead and deburden yourself tonight? In fact, what God will do for you, He will bless you, and He will come and deburden you for you, because you don't know how to deburden yourself. He'll come take your yoke. He'll come take your burden. We make it far more difficult than it is. The Lord says, I have a drink for you. That's about how difficult it is. I have a drink. What'd you drink? Do you know how to swallow? Do you know how to take a drink? He makes it so simple. And He said, if you take a drink out of your belly, out of your emotions, out of your belly, out of your kalia, in the Greek language is kalia, out of your emotions shall come up floods, rivers of love, of joy, of peace, of the divine expressions of heaven, of those things which only God the Holy Ghost can produce. See, God the Holy Ghost was not available to men. It's not been available to men. God the Holy Ghost, from the time that Adam transgressed against God and rebelled against God and chose to be on the other side, man lost everything that belonged to the realms of heaven. Man has just simply been deprived of all the goodness of God. He's been deprived of it and depraved in his emotions and in the way that he's lived. Father's looking for somebody to just be willing to take up an offer to come in and step into the goodness and the glory that has been brought to us by Christ Jesus. Amen. That day, the fountain of life was cut off from man. The realms of the glory of the Holy Ghost in which man was shaped in was cut off from him. Then every once in a while, there would be someone who would be willing to walk with God, like an Enoch. An Enoch, about six generations from Adam, Enoch pleased God so much so wanted to walk with Father, so pleased him. And of course, we know a lot about Enoch from the book of faith, Hebrews chapter 11. We know that without faith, it's impossible to please God, because those that come to God must believe that he exists, that he's here. Tonight, we want to prove to you that he's here, and he's given us the privilege and the ability to prove it. It's reproducible. We can prove that he's here, and we'll do that as the course of time goes on tonight. God took him, and he didn't see death because he just pleased God. He walked over into a realm that is just amazing. And, you know, we can talk more about that because of he's got a future work too as well. Then there was another man came along, was willing to walk with God, willing to obey God, willing, hungry for more than what everybody else seemed to be contented with. And Father showed him how it was possible to walk out the kind of life that he has for man, and the things that were essential for him to do. He said, you got to leave everything. You got to go. You got to remove yourself from all your family and all the things that you know, because all it's going to do is hold you into ideas and religious concepts. It's going to separate you from me. Because this is basically what was going on. Listen to me. Because I'm talking to you. I'm not talking about Abraham. I'm talking about you, actually. Talk about you. Because we want to just make it about Abraham. Don't want to ever bring it too personal. I'm going to talk about you. God said, I want you to leave everything. I want you to go to a place with me where all there is me. And so God called him Ivrit. And Ivrit means Hebrew. And Hebrew means one who stands on the other side of the flood with God. It was him and God alone. You know, we have God in a situation where Satan comes to him one day and says, I've been walking throughout the earth up and down. I've been beholding all that's going on among men. And basically the innuendo in Job chapter 1 and chapter 2 is Satan is saying, they all want to serve me. They're all on my side. They all like the shame, the fear. They all like the devastation, the discouragement, the disappointment. They love to kill each other. They love to hate each other. And God says, hey, I got one guy. Do you consider my one guy? God's always got one guy. People think that Father is over in the realms of the majority, and he's never in the realms of the majority. Somebody said, well, you're just one person. I'm one person with a big, gigantic Bible. I'm one person with a big, gigantic word from heaven with a whole bunch of proofs to say this is what God is saying. God's always had the small group. He's always had the minority. Jesus said the way to life, the way that I'm talking about, that God has for you, the way of abundant life, the way of this joyous life, the way of this life of divine glory, the divine nature, the presence of God, it's narrow, and very few people go on it. I was talking to a woman that we've actually been praying for over 30 years the other night. And as I begin to talk to her, after 30 years of prayer, at the age of 79 years old, her heart began to open up. And we just began to talk to her about the way is narrow. You want to make it broad, but it's narrow. You want to make many ways to God. You want to make everything acceptable to God. But reality of it is, if everything is acceptable to God, then heaven's going to be as big a hell as it is right now. There's going to be no heaven. Heaven means there's no more sin. Heaven means there's no more hate. Heaven means there's no more murder. Heaven means there's no more discouragement and disappointment and sadness and sorrow and death and sighing gone. She got up the next morning after we had spent some time talking and she said, you know, I spent all night thinking about what you said and I recognize that you're right. She said, but you're going to have to be patient with me. I've been a humanist all my life. That's a miracle. 79 years old. Academic professional. It's a miracle. See, we never quit praying for people. God never quits praying for people. God prays. Did you know that Jesus forever has defined his existence about praying for you to break you out of all the stuff that you think that you know about God? Father's looking for you and I to come and recognize that his word tends to life and expresses to us his thoughts, his ideas, and releases us from all of our thoughts and our ideas. And as soon as we get over into his thoughts and his ideas and start obeying what he says instead of going with our own opinions, life is really good. The living word came and showed us the written word. The living word came and established in our hearts. He wrote in our hearts and in our minds. I know some people think that the mind's not redeemed. That's nonsense. He wrote into our minds a new covenant. Is Hebrews 8:10, Hebrews 10:16, Jeremiah 31, 32, 33, Ezekiel 36, 26. List goes on. He wrote in our hearts and in our minds his word and his statutes so that we would keep them, so that we would be his God. He would be our God and we would be his people. I mean, he established within us his living word, his ways, giving us a new spirit and a new heart so that we can be 100% belonging to God and nothing left outside of his presence. But yet we don't cooperate with that. We don't hook up with that. Father is here patiently trying to teach us how to yield. Listen, at the end of the day, we'll say, God did it all the signs, all the wonders, all the miracles, all the beautiful manifest presence of God. But he's got to have somebody who's going to cooperate with him. And that manifest glory and those miracles and those signs and wonders are going to be a result of someone who's learned how to yield him, because Father wants a oneness with us. He wants to be one with our spirit, and we allow our spirit to be one with other stuff, or at least mixed with other things. And when our spirit's mixed with other things, it can't fully be one with him. But yet he continues in his mercy and his love. Tonight we'll have communion, and communion speaks of the privilege that we have by the blood of Jesus Christ to be absolutely purified from every sin, that we can stand pure, pure, perfectly pure before him and have communion with him, have fellowship with him because of the blood that he gave, because of what he did when he offered his own body on the cross. He through his death destroyed him that had the power of death, Satan. He through the body of his flesh destroyed the power of sin, that we might now through his death be made righteous and holy, pure, unrebukable, unreprovable in his sight. But yet, we chart off our own course. And Father's constantly saying, when are you going to allow my word to rule over you? He's exalted his word above his name. He's fixed his word and is forever settled in the heavens. He's given to us the living word so that you and I would be conformed to the word. He's given to us the written word so that you and I would be conformed to the word. We've got to recognize it's more than black ink on white paper, that it's living and it's powerful. It's spirit and it's life. If we will do it, it will create within us all those things that Father has described. That's how we've been born again. That's how we've been born from above. We've been born by an incorruptible seed, which is called the word of God, which lives and abides forever. His word produces faith within our life. His word works effectually within us, or the power of divine working of God on the inside of us, so that everything about our life, it would be conformed to the image of God. It is through the word that we're able to grow and mature spiritually. It's about time we get on with the process instead of being constantly compromised with all of our other desires. Because I'm telling you, Father's made up his mind. He released long ago the privilege for you and I to walk around in the fullness of his glory and shine as a new race of people on the planet. I'm talking about a new race of people. I'm not talking about just going on as mere men. Paul said you behave as mere men in Corinthians chapter 3 because you continue to walk in your strife and you continue to walk in your divisions. You continue to walk in a carnal thinking. The definition of a carnal mind is to be a baby in Christ. And the evidence of it is strife and divisions and complaints and murmurings. And there still goes on in people's life and in their homes. I see people and I see that they have a demonic stronghold in their homes that causes husband and wife to argue with each other. And they make that normal and natural and don't recognize it's nothing more than a demon power that they have authority over through the name of Jesus Christ to stop, so that they can start living out a life of communion and oneness and love and relationship. And in the midst of that, God gets bigger. I mean, it's not that he's bigger, he just gets bigger. He's just always been really big, but he gets bigger. You listening to me? He begins to become greatly revealed within our life. We begin to grow and mature, and we begin to step into something far more, just far more than what we have right now. Just listen to me. Just listen to me. Don't let anything distract you. God's got something far more than what you have right now, and you don't have to earn it. You don't have to beg God for it. You just got to start simply obeying God and cooperate with him. I mean, Father's put no limits, no restraints, no reservations on all that he has. I can give you right now a list of scriptures where the Lord says, whatever you ask, it's yours. You can have it. Whatever you ask, it's yours. You can have it. Whatever you want, whatever you say, whatever you desire. I mean, verses of scripture like Mark chapter 11, verse 24, whatever you ask, you can have it. John 14, John 15, John 16, 1 John 3, all of it. 1 John 3, 22, 23. All these scriptures say, whatever you want, just ask. Amen. Whatever you want. But we don't have that living experience because we don't recognize that there's things that we're not willing to simply believe about God, because his word is going to be the source of us being able to believe what he says. His word, obedience to his word, is going to result in us believing. We don't understand that. It's not a reward. It's just an adjustment. It's a change. It's a change of our behavior. It's a change of our thinking. And somebody said to me not too long ago, they said, Mark, something, some event happened to you, you really were renewed in the spirit of your mind. Because it is a new form, it's a modern form of a second work of grace. Wesley talked about a sanctification or a second work of grace back in his day. And now there's a new terminology for a sanctification or a second work of grace, and that is having your mind renewed and dealing with some soulish nature that has no basis in the scripture. But nonetheless, it's a very popular opinion. And it's always some license for Satan to be able to have some freedom in our life. It's always some wiggle room for the devil. And when he's got wiggle room, he's going to, I'm telling you right now, he's going to make a disaster of the place. He's a bull in a china closet, okay? Are you listening to me? Shut the door so he can't get in. Are you with me? Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Listen, The reality of it is if you want to be renewed in the spirit of your mind, really what the scripture says, just start thinking different about yourself. Amen. Listen to me. God says, just think different about yourself. Listen, I hear so many people make all these comments about verses of scripture that they and they use one word and they go to seed on it. You ought to learn Greek or you ought to learn Hebrew so you make sure you got the right definition. Because the scripture literally says in Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 23, and in Romans chapter 12 and verse 2, the only two times that these particular concepts appear to be renewed in the spirit of your mind simply says, in common vernacular, think different about yourself. And really, look at the context. How are you going to think different about yourself? Seeing as God said all these things about you, think different about yourself. Well, how are you going to do that? Because I don't care whether you want to say, renewed in the spirit of your mind, and whatever that is. Are you listening to me? Yes. Can you hear me? Because I don't think so many people can hear me. Because I like to challenge people. You just tell me what it means to be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Just tell me exactly what you mean. Because then all of a sudden when somebody starts trying to tell me what they mean by renewed in the spirit of mind, they're talking about second work of Christ. Huh? But when you understand it for what it really is, it's just thinking different about yourself. In other words, thinking according to what God said in his word. Now you're thinking faith. Now you're being willing to obey the word of God. Now you're living not by bread alone, but by every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God. Now you're letting the word of God rule you. Now you're letting the word of God govern you. Now you're letting the word of God tell you who you are and what God is to you and what he's done for you and what he's made you. Now you don't look at yourself based upon what everybody said about you in elementary school, what your peers said about you, what your parents said about you. Now all of us, or what you say about you. Now you're believing what God says about you. You start thinking different and faith begins to rise. Suddenly, you don't see yourself as a sinner anymore. You see yourself as a saint. That's a great empowerment right there. Because if you walk around with the identity of a sinner, guess what you're going to do? You're going to sin. You belong to the devil. I mean, men became so corrupt and depraved that, and really the corruption and the depravity ultimately took place at the moment that there was a spiritual change. When Adam transgressed against God. And the Lord looked at the people of the covenant in the day that he was standing on this earth 2,000 years ago. And he said, you are from beneath. I am from above. Your father is the devil. My father is the living God. Then the Lord looks at us and he empowers us and he says, after he gives us the call, and he says, you must be born from above. Because actually, the Greek language actually would be more perfectly translated, you must be born from above. Or you can say born again, either one. It means the same. Are you with me? Yes. One is more direct from where the birth comes from. You must be born from above. You must be born of the Spirit, the Holy Ghost. And having been born from above, the Lord looks at us and says, you're not of the world, even as I'm not of the world. He makes us absolutely transcendent other from everything in this world. He makes a new race. He made a new race. Hallelujah. And he... Father God is the father of this race, and Christ Jesus is the first fruits of this race, and we all right now have his blood, have his life as the means by which we exist. People without Christ Jesus, they're another species. They don't have life. They don't have this life. They are under the authority of a demonic power. They live out the death life. They live out the death walk. They live under the rule and the authority of the prince and the power of the air, the God of this world, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience. Not so with those who are born of the Spirit. We walk in the Spirit. We live in the Spirit. Hallelujah. We speak after the things of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. We're filled with the Holy Ghost. We're led by the Holy Ghost. We're governed by the Holy Ghost. The Holy Spirit is our teacher. The Holy Spirit is our guide. The Holy Spirit is our leader. We commune with him. We his tabernacle. We his temple. He's not just come inside of us just a little bit. He's come and lived on the inside of us fully. He gives us the opportunity to be continually filled with himself. Amen. People got all these ideas about how the days are going to be redeemed. I guarantee you, Trump ain't going to do it. I guarantee you that the other guys that Hillary Clinton isn't going to do it. I think more people are agreeing with that among the people of God that Hillary Clinton isn't going to do it. She's not going to redeem the times. Trump definitely ain't going to do it. And it's a coin toss for me. Which one's worse? Okay, but nonetheless, I'm leaving that for another day. the reality of it is the way the time's going to be redeemed, the way the days are going to be redeemed, the way that the possibility of a light shining and people being changed is you and I being filled with the Spirit.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Speaking to ourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, allowing this river to gush out of us. I mean, when's the last time you put a water meter on your river? Hello. When's the last time you got a little check about whether or not you got, you know, 1 gallon per day? Or a river which flows in the trillions of gallons per hour? Hello? I mean, come on. The Lord quantitated it. Everybody looks at me all sour-like because now all of a sudden you're going to have to step up to a measure. God has given us the opportunity, and He's made it so easy. Somebody says, you're preaching works. I'm not preaching works. I'm preaching faith. Show me your faith without your works. I'll show you my faith by my works. But I'm preaching faith. I'm preaching a supernatural divine ability that is given to us by the Holy Ghost because you can't do it without Him. Hello! You can't do anything the Word of God describes without the Holy Ghost. He wasn't available till recently. Now that He's available, people made a religion out of Him. They trample all over the anointing, wonder why God don't move. They do their own things. They still like to carouse with demon power and sin and be involved in the lust of the flesh and lust of the eye and pride of life only because they never stepped into the glory where the pleasure is. Because in His presence is fullness of joy, and His right hand is pleasures forevermore. God's got it going on. It's far better in His presence and doing what He's doing than it's ever been doing what demon spirits are doing. I tell you, and then if I just broke it down, if I begin to slice it up a little bit and just talk about earthly interest, selfish earthly interest. Paul said in Colossians chapter 3, he said for us to seek those things which are above, to set our affections on things above, not on things of this earth. And Paul made a very extreme distinction between earthly interest and worldly interest. Earthly interest being made, basically being caught up in what shall I wear and what shall I eat and where are we going to live? Because after all, you know, God expects us to help. He helps them who helps themselves. A scripture that more people have memorized than any other verse of scripture in the Bible, and it's not even in the Bible because He actually helps those who cannot help themselves, who recognize they can do nothing without Him. But by Him, they can do all things, you know, with total abandonment. It says, I'm going to leave everything behind. I'm going to go to a place where I don't know where I'm going to go. I'm going to make myself vulnerable to everything that could be out there to destroy me. Because I'm willing to believe that God is God. I'm willing to make Him God, that He's God. Tonight, I just pray that you don't leave out of here not willing to let God be God, that He's a big enough God to do what Jesus said, that it was essential for you to begin to get your heart sold out to Him, to get your life sold out to Him, so that you don't take thought for what you, or be concerned about what you eat or what you're going to wear. You just go after the kingdom. And you're so going after the kingdom that if it means that you're going to have to, you know, miss out on a paycheck, if you're going to miss out on church, you're going for missing out on the paycheck. You're not going to miss out on the church because you're going to have some measurable realities in your life of what is actually the kingdom. Otherwise, you're going to be just as confused as everybody else, and you're going to be soon sorted out and deceived. God really very clearly identifies for us what are the principles and what are the things of the kingdom. He clearly identifies, just like He identifies for us, what are the weapons of our warfare. I see people running around getting so distracted with what is the weapons of our warfare, which are not carnal but mighty through God. He's given to us all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. I mean, He's given to us first and foremost the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. I mean, my goodness, that's not for slicing bread. That's for taking heads. The Word of God is so powerful. Jesus destroyed everything that Satan could throw at Him just preaching, just speaking some Old Testament Deuteronomy chapter 8 stuff. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Are you just Deuteronomy 8, things that people say, oh, that's Old Testament. They don't even like it. That's how Jesus destroyed everything Satan threw at Him. Are you listening to me? Come on now. It's real simple. He showed us how easy it is to absolutely destroy every power of darkness. I write unto you, young men, because the Word of God abides in you, and you have defeated Satan at every point. Jesus showed us how to do it, and John talked about it. I write unto you, young men, because the Word of God abides in you, and you're not speaking your own stuff anymore. You're speaking what Father said. You're not thinking your own way anymore. You're thinking it according to what Father's decreed and spoken. One single word from heaven, that's how powerful it is.
There's nothing more powerful than the Word of God. It has framed the heavens. Hallelujah. I mean, listen, the universe is bigger than everybody thinks it is. Hallelujah. Because it reflects His eternal glory. There is no Big Bang event. In other words, if there's a Big Bang event, then there's going to be an envelope. A place where you could see the nothingness, the vacuum of nothingness, and then the expanding universe. Such doesn't exist. Man will never find it. In 4 to 5 years, they're going to have all the equipment that they need to be able to observe it. And I've already told the guys over there at NASA, I said, listen, you ain't going to see it. And you're going to look, and it ain't going to be there. Just remember that you can come back and talk to me about how I knew it. How did I know? How did I know? How did I know? How could I possibly be willing to actually think this way? Because the Word of God has come to give us the insight and the revelation for not only everything about how He's purposed us to be, but everything begin to unveil and reveal who He is. Jesus came and revealed the fullness of the Father. He said, this is Him. You see me, you see the Father. He came. God purposed that all His fullness should dwell in Him bodily. And bodily, He revealed all of His fullness. And guess what the church is actually supposed to be right now? The church is actually supposed to express all the fullness of God so that everything about God is being revealed to humanity. But we're busy doing our own stuff. We made a religion out of His glory. And we lost the glory. Not here, but I mean, that's in general. I haven't lost the glory. I'm living in the move of God all the time. I'm is always there. It's one of the weapons of my warfare, which slays Satan at every point. God gave us authority. The first authority He gave to us, He gave us the ability, the authority to cast out demon spirits, to have authority over all unclean spirits. Listen, you never bind a strong man. You never spoil a strong man's house until you first bind him. If you don't understand how to deal with demon spirits in your own life, coming at your own life, you're never going to be free to function in all the freedom and glorious liberty that Christ Jesus has given to us, because you'll be subjugated by His law. Lies, by demonic lies. Will God forgive us? Forgive us over and over again, so long as you're willing to at some point walk in the Holy Ghost, because He says, I'll forgive you as many times as you need to be forgiven in a day, but you got to forgive everybody else of their trespasses against you. Ain't nobody forgiving anybody any trespasses from their heart without the Holy Ghost. That's a supernatural divine ability where the love of God begins to surge through your being and mercy overwhelms you and forgiveness just flows from you. Come on. Yeah. Come on. Yeah. Somebody said, oh, he didn't quote the scripture right. It's supposed to be 7 times 70. That is a Hebrewism for as much as you need. It's not 490 times in a day, but take 490 times. That's pretty. Now, that's a lot. The Father says it's unlimited mercy, it's unlimited grace, it's unlimited provision. My blood never loses its power. It's there to continually cleanse if you walk in the light. And without His Word, there is no light. His Word is the light unto the world, a light unto your path. It shows you the next step to take. Oh, the life you'll start living if you take every step by the Word of God instead of your own speculation. And I'm telling you, self-justification, self-righteousness will kick in quicker than you can even imagine. Because your brain, your mind, your thinking play tricks on you. Your imaginations will play tricks on you. Deception is a formidable foe. Everybody who has been infected by it doesn't know it. Do you understand? Yes. No one who is deceived is recognized that they're. No one who's deceived recognizes that they're deceived. Otherwise, they wouldn't be deceived. The power of a lie. What is the Word of God? It's truth. What does it do? Sets free. From what? Lies. What does the light do? Liberates you from what? The darkness. Praise God. Hallelujah. The Lord didn't leave us any, didn't leave. I mean, Satan, Jesus said, Satan comes and he has no part in me. I'm in Jesus, so I got the same thing. I got the same report. Every report that there is about Jesus, I got the report because I'm in Him. Because there is no exist day outside of Jesus. You don't exist. You don't even have life outside of Him. He's called us to come and dwell in Him and abide in Him. God has given us an anointing of the Holy Ghost that teaches us this one single thing, that we're supposed to dwell in God. That means everything about our life, we see ourselves in the midst of God and God in the midst of us. He's mighty at work in the midst of me. Come on. people. This is the glory of salvation we've been talking about. This is the gospel. This is the good news. The good news is you've been completely liberated from the devil, from the power of darkness, from sin and death. That's the good news. People think the good news is that they can continue to live like the devil and be right with God. That's not the good news. In fact, that's bad news. That's bad, bad, bad news. Because now everything that God did had no effective change to bring any reality of life and goodness and truth into our existence. Huh? Well, that is the same as we are. I tell you, no, that's not true. Those who are being in Christ Jesus, any man who is in Christ Jesus is a new creation. Old things have passed away, and every single thing is new, and everything is of God. But that's a gift. That's a gift. He gave us a gift of righteousness. He gave us a gift of holiness, because it's all part and parcel to the gift of life. But he gave it to us so that we now may grow and mature and be fashioned in all of his goodness and glory. But that means we got to participate. That means we got to be willing to walk it out. Hello. We can't just do whatever we want to do and say, oh, well, you know, God understands that I need to go do this, and God understands that I need to go that, and he recognizes that we're all going to sin more or less every day. We're just all hopelessly bound up by unclean spirits, and Satan still has authority over us, because nobody has authority to tread upon scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy, so that nothing can by any means hurt them. That's just what Jesus said. That certainly can't be what really happens every day, because we actually believe that everybody's supposed to sin more or less every day. That's our doctrine. Jesus had a different doctrine. John had a doctrine is, we know that everybody who's born of God doesn't sin. They knew that. We don't know that, because we got other doctrines that have completely changed it all. And then we wonder, why is it that we don't have the reproducible, living reality of all those things that God has said? The unlimited possibilities, the without restraint opportunities, without reservation. God, without reservation, says, whatever you want, ask me, I'll do it. This is why I called you and ordained you. This is why I sought you out. This is why I elected you. That whatever you ask me, I'll give it to you. That all the world, really what he's saying in the overtone is, all the world may see the relationship that you now have through my only begotten Son, Father being glorified through it all. Is that amazing? People, this is an opportunity. All we've got to do, all we've got to be willing to do is start living by the word. It's just that simple. You read it, do it. He says it, believe it. Don't say it can't be. Don't say it's an impossibility. Hallelujah. Just agree with God. Start obeying him. They thought, don't they? Listen, I mean, I believe people just took Matthew chapter 5, Matthew chapter 6, Matthew chapter 7, and just started living it, and their whole life would be changed. True. I mean, just get one paragraph and live it. Living one paragraph has got to change you and result in you living out whole chapters and then living out whole books. Hallelujah. And then living out the whole thing. Jesus said, I come in the volume of the book. From Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21, it's all about me. I come in the volume of the book. It is written, to do thy will, O God. If there's anything you and I want to understand, is that one little phrase, to do thy will, because many will say, Lord, Lord, or that means he is absolutely my Lord, but he's going to say to them on that day, depart from me, I have no idea who you are. He's going to say it. Depart from me. I have no idea who you are, you worker of iniquity. That's what, man, I tell you right now, it'll make you tremble. The 10 virgins, they were all, look at the 10 virgins. The 10 virgins, they all, look at the response. They all had lamps. They all responded to the bridegroom coming. They all fell asleep. But there was just five that they weren't prepared. That's all. And Luke talks about the similar parable when he says, those who know to prepare and don't do it, these are the ones who are cast out. And so you see what happens. Look, they just fell asleep. Go get oil, go to those who sell and buy, and then come on. Boy, they were committed. They were all the way going, all the way. They were walking through most everything that they were supposed to do, except for one dimension, just one dimension. And then they get to the wedding feast, and they bang on the door and say, open unto us. And the Lord cries out, I tell you, with absolute certainty, I have no clue who you are. People don't, humanism won't allow that. But see, you don't understand this. Humanism, the power of humanism, the principality of humanism rules the Western world. It rules it. And we don't know all the influences of the atmosphere that has impacted our life because our culture, our society, our peers, the people that we look to, parents, significant people in our life have been those who have imparted the doctrines of humanism, and they've been and the word of God that we've heard, much of the word of God that we've heard is laced with strychnine. I mean humanism. Laced with humanism. And the rebellion that came and is in the midst and expressed with in feminism and other dimensions of rebellion that has impacts upon us. And we're influenced by this stuff. And there's only one way that you and I are going to have a sure defense. We're going to have to walk in the glory of the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost is going to show us what he wants us to do through the word. So we're going to be doing the word when we're walking in the glory of the Holy Ghost. We're going to be doing the word. His word is going to be a shield and a buckler to us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, the Lord tells us he tries to get us our attention. He says, above everything else, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness with an urgency. Forget all about this stuff. He's like saying, quit your job. Don't worry about clothes. Live in a cave. It's almost like what he's saying. It's almost to that level. It's an urgency. Just go after the kingdom above everything else. Go after the kingdom and his righteousness. And then the Lord tries to help us understand through his apostle Paul what we're up against. He says, be strong now in the strength of the Lord and power of his might. This is what it's going to take. God's strength, God's power, God's might. That's a whole lot. Why? So that you may take unto yourself the whole armor of God so that you can be able to stand against the spiritual wickedness. So that you can be able to stand against what you're up against on a daily basis. Because Satan is rebellious. He's defiant against God. He does not believe a single person in here is saved, born again, on their way to heaven. He believes every one of you belong to him. Huh? He does. Ask him. You don't have, you probably heard his voice a bunch today, accusing you, slandering you, huh? Condemning you, trying to sort you out, trying to prove to you that you want lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, pride of life more than obedience to God, more than holiness, purity, righteousness, and all the glory of heaven and a manifest presence. See? He doesn't believe he's defeated. Now, one moment. How many of you think that Satan's actually submitted to the word of God? I tell you he's not. He's gonna come try to fight against God again. How many times has he got to be defeated? Right? He was cast down out of heaven. Jesus saw him cast down out of heaven, right? Then he was defeated at the cross. Jesus, through death, destroyed him that had the power of death, that is the devil. He abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. If I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. Now is the prince of this world cast out. Now is the prince of this world judged. I mean, come on. We know that he stripped, paralyzed Satan from his eyebrows down, right, of all their authority when at the cross. Colossians, Paul told us when he was preaching to the church at Colossae. He don't believe a single bit of it. It's true, but he don't believe any of it. It's true. You and I, the smallest saint, the smallest church person in the kingdom of God, has all authority ever over all hell. Hallelujah. In Christ Jesus' name. But he don't believe it. It's got to be proven to him. Huh? And it can be proven to him. Like the devil said, Paul I know and Jesus I know, but I don't have any idea who you are. I would hate to be talking to the devil, trying to cast the devil out, and the devil say that. Because next thing you know, you're going to get beat up. You know, these are things that are going to be established, and these are things that have got to be proven. Hallelujah. And God has given us the ability to have them established in our life. Hallelujah. He wants to be strengthened. He wants us to be strengthened by the Spirit in our inner being. Amen. So that we, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth, to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, and there be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him who is able to do superabundantly above all that we can think or ask, according to the power, the treasure, the Holy Ghost, Christ Jesus in us, God the Father living right here, the river that flows out of us. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Come on, people. You just got to start to, you got to recognize that what you've been eating isn't substantive, that powerful. You're going to have to start being willing to live by the word of God.
You're going to have to start daily delighting in the Word of God. You're going to have to be willing to start having a personal relationship with the Holy Ghost and saying, Holy Spirit, I'm yours, lead on. I want to be sensitive to you. I want to learn how to hear your voice. I want to learn how to walk in your direction. I want to learn how to stand in your strength. I want to learn how to stand in your discernment. I want to learn how to overcome Satan just like Jesus overcame Satan. I want to learn how to be tried at every point and be able in at every point to find myself an overcomer. How is that? What's the secret of it? The Word. Where? Abides where? Where? The Word of God is, where is it? It's in my heart. People say, oh, it's a wicked heart. I got a pure heart. I got one just like God. He gave me his own heart. I got a new heart. Hallelujah. And it's a place where faith is at. It's a place where if doubt works, it's going to mess up everything. But when faith is in my heart, when I stand in faith, when I forgive from the heart, when I walk in this pure heart, I get to, my goodness, have all those things that Father has blessed us with in the spiritual realm, in the heavenly blessings. The heavenly blessings, the spiritual riches. We've been blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. He, out of his own riches of glory, is providing for us all things freely. And somebody said, oh, Mark takes verses of Scripture and he puts them together and acts like it's one. I know I'm hybriding Scriptures and I'm not taking them out of context. And I give you the scriptural references if you want, but then I won't be able to say everything I need to say if I'm busy with that. You can look them up and you'll find out that what I'm telling you is the Word of God. I'm here an example. I'm here being an example to you, living by the Word of God, speaking the Word of God. I'm not really even so much interested in all of my successes or anybody else's successes and telling about all the things that I've done or anyone else has done. Well, we can talk about everything God has done, all the successes of God, all the great testimonies of Christ Jesus. Come on. All the great testimonies of the Holy Ghost. I recognize that the Word of God is powerful, living in my mind and my thinking realm, which comes out of my heart. It's my heart. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Every thought comes out of the heart. Are you listening to me? And I'm allowing Christ Jesus dwells in my heart. His Word dwells in my heart by faith. Faith is the testimony of the new creation. Are you understanding that? And new heart, new spirit, laws, Word written upon the heart. Hallelujah. He rules my heart. The priest of God rules my heart and my mind. I let the Word of Christ dwell in my heart richly. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's the same as being filled with the Spirit, isn't it? It's the Colossian expression of being filled with the Spirit. It's Ephesians 5:18. So the Colossians, let the Word of Christ dwell in your heart richly, speaking to yourself in psalms and hymns. Hallelujah. That means I got the Word of Christ right there, right there on the tip of my tongue, ready to speak out those things which are being spoken by Christ Jesus. How am I trained in it? How am I trained in it? How has my tongue become a pen of a ready writer? How do I learn how to speak by the Spirit? Because I give myself continually to the Word. I'm not Eli laying down the blind fatness, laziness of my spirit. I'm not this Hophni and Phinehas laying at the door of the tabernacle, committing all kinds of lewd acts and with the people of God stealing from the people of God. I'm like Samuel. I'm laying down by the light that's shining in before the tabernacle of the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm laying down there before the Word of the living God being taught out of this realm of His glory and out of His goodness and out of His knowledge and out of His understanding. Hallelujah. Praise God. You know, we make a big emphasis on the Word of knowledge and that manifestation of the gift of the Spirit, the Word of knowledge. And praise God, you should. But many people misunderstand it because the Word of knowledge as a phrase is only used very few times in the Scripture, twice in the Scripture. What is primarily used is the knowledge of God. And the knowledge of God is the same as the Word of knowledge. The knowledge of God is the Word which He declared, Genesis chapter 1, verse 1 through Revelation 22:21. And being back, growing up in among the time when people still were flowing in the Holy Ghost in a greater dimension and Pentecost was not yet waning as it is today. You listen to me. I watched people who function in the gift powerfully always have right at the center of it a verse of Scripture. Here's what the Lord's saying. You know, Psalms 19 verse 8 kind of thing. Here's what the Lord's saying. Here's a specific application. Praise God for that. Somebody speaking the knowledge of God, speaking the Word of God, instead of speaking out of their own mind, out of their own thinking, out of their own imaginations.
You're listening to me. Dear people, there's a communion that God wants us to have. And the communion that he wants us to have is oneness with himself. Get everything in your doctrine, everything in your life, everything in your thinking, everything in your behavior into a place of union with him. Just receive it as a gift. See, you were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. Every day of your life, you were shaped to be just like the devil. You're shaped to think like the devil, act like the devil, be just in a perfect fit in the kingdom of darkness. Are you listening to me? One day you were born in righteousness, to be shaped now in purity by the Holy Ghost. Every day shaped, every day mature, every day grow. But you're not going to have that unless you're giving yourself to the Word. You give yourself to the Word, you're going to fall in love with me. You don't give yourself to the Word, you're not going to like me. You're going to say, this is weird, man. All this stuff he's saying, he's bringing this thing down so heavy. My goodness, who does he think he is? I know exactly who I am. I'm in Christ Jesus. Christ Jesus is in me. I am a son of God given the authority of Christ Jesus, the Son of God, to speak on his behalf, in his place, as his ambassador, in his stead. Hallelujah. I'm the temple of the living God. God the Father lives here. How do you like that? Holies of holies have been moved into my heart. Praise God. What do you think about yourself? What do you believe about yourself? I believe what God said about me. I don't know myself after the flesh. I know myself after the Spirit. The Lord says, Paul said, we're not supposed to know each other after the flesh, but after the Spirit. We don't even know Jesus after the flesh anymore. You understand? Because you could know Jesus after the flesh because I want to make sure you got the right flesh in your thinking. Are you listening to me? Because people are confused with the many different applications. Are you listening to me? Can everybody hear me pretty good? Praise God. But if you're going to be able to do that, you're going to have to start off with not knowing yourself after the flesh, but after the Spirit. And somebody said, what does that mean? They that are born of the Spirit are spirit, and they that are born of the flesh are flesh. And so that Paul says in Romans 8, 9, he says, you are no longer in the flesh, but in the Spirit. So it's about time you start understanding that so that you can look now with an unveiled face and behold in the mirror the glory and thereby change. Behold there the image and be changed there from glory to glory. As long as you're looking at old you, the old you, the old, old man, former old creature you, with all your failings and problems and issues, and unlike God, you're never going to move into the things that the Father has. You're never going to lay aside the weight of your own opinion, the weight of your own ideas, the weight of all the demonic influences and all the lies. Huh? Are you listening to me? Isn't it terrible to pull up to somebody and ask them for directions, and then you just all earnest, you in a hurry, you're running late, they give you directions, they sent you in the opposite way you're supposed to be going? Or what's even worse is they sent you in the general direction, but you're still five blocks off. Huh? And you're late. People, don't go with other people's directions. Yeah. Listen, God's word is the roadmap to heaven. You can't add to it. You can't put in a couple additional turns. Huh? A couple of forks in the road, a couple of stops along the way. He ain't never going to get there on time. He's not just getting there, it's getting there on time. Are you with me? Everybody would be saved one moment after death. I've asked the Lord, well, Lord, why won't we do that? Why won't we do that program? Everybody surely would give their life to you one moment after they're dead. 1 second after hell, they give their life to you because they won't be changed. Their heart won't change. Because there's all these evidences right now of Father. Father has purposed to leave himself in an unseen realm so that he may deal with the areas of our life that is essential by him functioning that way. Not after the sense realm, but after the heart realm, after the unseen realm. And people, the only the people that are going to be changed based upon their circumstances and based upon their events and based upon what they see are never really changed. They never really changed. God's proved it over and over again. That's why there is no salvation 1 second after you're dead, even though everybody would sign up. Huh? Because you know what? 2 days after they delivered from hell, they're right back being the devil. Huh? You watch it. How many of you have seen, catastrophe type salvations, right? Huh? Desperate situations, crisis salvations, right? 1 week they forgot all about their promises and commitment. Oh, they got to serve God every day of their life if you just get them out of this. And he got them out of it. And where are they back? They're right back in the bar. They're right back doing the same kind of iniquity and thinking the same way and speaking the same way and acting the same way. Right? Because nothing changed. It was a circumstance and an event that brought a change. It wasn't a heart change. It wasn't responding to having truth in the inward part to say, wait a minute, there's evidence coming and going for all mankind knows. Everyone knows God is who he says he is. Everyone on the inside, they know. It's not, they know. It's there. It's fingerprinted upon them. Yeah. That's why there is no agnostic or atheist in the foxhole. Everybody's praying, crying out to God. Huh? Yes. Are you listening to me? Yes. It's easy to get Muslims converted to Jesus in the foxhole. Easy. Huh? Because they know Muhammad's not there to help them. It's already been proven. It's easy to get Buddhists converted in the foxhole because they know Krishna's not there to help them. He's dead and gone. Never said he was coming back. Huh? Said, if you get it right, you might see me one day. And if you sin one time, by the way, you're going to have 76,000 life cycles as a lower creature. And then, if you come back again, you get another chance, one sin, you can go back. Square one. All right? That's all they got. That's why when you say to Hindus, you can have all of your sins washed away right now. Christ Jesus is here standing right here at this moment in time. He's given the provision to wash every one of your sins away so that your life is pure and right and holy before God, no matter what you've done, no matter what kind of wickedness. They come running. I watched them come running by the thousands and multitudes of thousands, more than you could number. Praise God. Blessed to be able to do that. I'm going to do it some more. Yeah. Amen. I love being in third world. I love it. I love the response in the unreached people groups. I believe that more than 3 billion people who've never had one opportunity to hear the name of Jesus ought to be our focus, instead of just going around, the other approximately 4 billion people and just telling them again and again and again and again and again, and there's not a whole lot of change. Are you listening to me? Well, but the Father's told me over and again, when I'm in that situation, come back and talk to you till you get it so you can go. He wants to halapase rinaya. Watch what Papa God's going to do. He's about ready to pour out a dimension of his glory through the people who are already set in a position with him to move all the way with him. And I believe right now that there is a lot of radical millennials out there and other, we got these various different names for different generations out there, that as soon as they see the reality of who he is, they're going to radically give their life over to Jesus. Amen. Yes, amen. Summer's one of them. Amen. I know a whole list of them. I've seen a bunch of different ones, They're just waiting for the encounter of the reality of who Christ Jesus is. And guess what? They're waiting to see it through you. They're waiting to see through you. Just unveiled glory of Jesus Christ while you're busy with whatever problem you have, your hangnail or whatever it was. Huh? The fact that your bank account went down to whatever it was. And you're trying, your savings account's diminishing a little bit and you're in a full panic. I just want to come over and laugh at you for a couple of hours when the money is no more valuable. I just want to come and laugh. Could I come and laugh? Because I think I would find it extremely humorous to just look at the perplexity upon your face when your money is no more good. And I've told you over and again, don't put your trust in money. Let faith be built in your life. And yet you wouldn't do it. You just continue to put your trust in money. And faith will never be built in your life while you put your trust in your money and all these other things. You're just going to be marginalized by your own unwillingness to obey God. But if you give yourself over to living by faith, your faith will get so strong, my goodness, in the midst of the crisis, you won't even know it. You won't even know it. There'll be famine. You won't even know it. Because you made God the sole object of your trust. You didn't put any trust at all in the arm of flesh and your own human ability and your own thinking and your own planning and your own strategizing. None. I got none. Zero. I stand here tonight with zero trust in myself. Hallelujah. I recognize that all my trust is in him. And if there's any place where I trust in myself, I want Father to show me quickly. Because I want to abhor it because I hate that. I hate it. And so forgive me while I hate it in you. Forgive me why I just think it's such an ugly looking wart on your forehead kind of thing. Third eye thing hanging in your nose or whatever. I couldn't tell you how repulsive enough it is to me. But it's repulsive to me first. About me. I don't want it. Sin is repulsive to me. Foolishness. It's actually foolishness is the place of origin, Greek, comes from a word, moron. More, also became a more, became a Arabic word, more perfectly pronounced moron, and English take it up as moron, and that's what a fool is. Why live that way? And what did the five moronic virgins, foolish virgins, have to do to become categorized as a moron? Are you with me? Are you listening to me? I like to really emphasize these things so you kind of hear it a little differently. I like to underscore it and say, wait, don't do that. Don't be that way. Because we try to make ourselves far removed from those things that we don't like. And I pray that what you don't like is everything that's contrary to the Word of God. Everything that doesn't look like is complete conformity to the Word, the living Word, Christ Jesus. Complete conformity to the Word, the written Word. Hallelujah. And then this is so beautiful just to start over again. Just start over again. Just read the Word again. I believe if God's people start reading the Word. Somebody said, I read the Bible one time. I read the Bible all the way through. It's like, whoopee-doo. First time I read the Bible all the way through, I didn't understand anything. After about the 100th time, you start to pick up on this stuff. This is the Word of God. I read the Bible all the way through. Are you trying to impress me? In reality, most people haven't read the Bible all the way through. They spot checked, you know what I'm saying. Or they say, well, my mama read it to me when I was a child. That don't even count. That is not even done. Or I listening to it on tape. You were buzzed and staring off into space. That doesn't count. But if you begin to read the Word of God, give yourself to the reading of the Word, then the Holy Spirit corrects us. He straightens us out. He shows us the places that we've been allowing things that are not right, wrong ideas, wrong beliefs, doctrines of men. Doctrines of men. You don't understand this. Doctrines of men flood the church today. Doctrines of devils are involved in the church today. When I asked the Lord when I was younger, a younger preacher. I'm still young now, but when I was a younger preacher, I used to think that people that were 56 years old were getting old. Now it's young. But at any rate, I asked the Lord, I said, Lord, what's the difference between doctrines of men and doctrines of devils? And the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me and helped me understand that the doctrines of men will keep you from the blessings of God and the doctrines of devils will keep you out of heaven. You know, I've got more things to say about this because I want to talk to you. I want to persuade you about what it means to learn how to yield to the Holy Ghost. The Word of God teaches you to yield. Hallelujah. Just finding this place of talking to the Father where you begin to enjoy His presence. You're not really praying until you're enjoying His presence. Listen to me right now. That's why we love the joy. We love seeing people get touched with the joy, touched by His love, touched by His presence. You know, we're going to do communion tonight. I'm trying to get to it. You can't have communion unless you've been born of the Spirit and you're sold out to live in purity. You listen to me. Not impurity, but in purity. Are you with me? I'll make sure. I think sometimes people are like hearing wrong. Okay? You got to be so, because otherwise you can't have this. This is all about your communion, that your garments are spotless, that you've given yourself over to no longer live for yourself. See, we thus judge, if one died for all, then all are dead, that we henceforth no longer live unto ourselves, but to live unto Him who died for us and rose again. That's communion, a fellowship of oneness, that we live in Him. That Jesus said, if you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you dwell in me, or you abide in me. If you're not committed to dwelling in Him, living out your life in Him, you have no right to the table. Because the table says that you're living by His blood. You're living by His body. His body is meat indeed. Through the body of His flesh, He presents us faultless before God. And we like that. See, Jesus is a Savior for everybody who wants to be delivered from sin. He's not a Savior for those who want to continue in sin. Do you understand me? You understand that this is the doctrine of the Scripture. John made it so simple. He said, they that do righteousness are righteous even as He is righteous. They that sin are of the devil. Pretty simple, eh? And He said that over and over again in so many different ways so everybody can get it. And people go, I'm not going to listen to this because I don't believe it, because I think we're all supposed to, you know, none of us can walk like that with God. It's because you don't want to walk that way with God. Just be honest. Be honest. See, men sit in darkness and in the shadow of death. What a sad situation. But the light sprang up. What a glorious situation. But men love darkness rather than light because they love the evil. Back to the sad situation. Reality of that's it. I want to do my own thing. I want to walk in my own lust. I want to walk in my own ways. I feel better about doing my own thing even though I continually live empty on the inside, sad, sorrowful, depressed, discouraged, and almost fully demon-possessed still. When all the time you can live this life of joy unspeakable and full of glory. It's supposed to be measurable. Fruits of salvation, joy unspeakable, full of glory. I get up in the morning, check my joy. Huh? But the fruits of salvation, peace that passes understanding. I check my peace. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because peace is not the absence of the war. Peace is the absence of condemnation. Woo-hoo. That's what he says. That's what he says. Peace unto those who are far away and to those who are near. That means there's no more condemnation. Come on in. Behold me. There's therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Notice the in him, one with him, dwelling in him. He's dwelling in us, and we're dwelling in him. That's the glory that we've received. People want the manifest presence, but they don't want to, you know, participate with how the manifest presence comes. Jesus said, the glory, Father, that you gave to me, I've given it to them so that they can be one just like we're one. Just as I am in you and you're in me, I'm in them and they're in me. The oneness. The oneness. Jesus said, in that day, the day that the Holy Ghost comes, in that day you will know that the Father is in me and I'm in you. Has that day come to you for you? See, there's people that don't have that, haven't had that day. They haven't had that day. They don't really know that Christ Jesus is walking on the inside of them because they haven't had that day. That day of when the Pentecost, when the Holy Ghost came, begin to cut the satana, begin to gush out. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Once again, I have many more things to say like this, but I just want to kind of make a transition over just a little bit more into just talking to you about. Now, this is the fourth night that we've been having communion and together and just ministering on communion, ministering on the table and the goodness of the table. And, of course, most of the nights it's just been all focused because there's so much to talk about here that, you know, this is far more than what people make it. With this communion and this fellowship is all symbolisms of that which we actually live out on a daily basis. It's a declaration that we're unreprovable, that we're holy, that we're unrebukable, that it's the declaration that we walked into the holies of holies, that we're communing with the Father, that he's communing with us. Hallelujah. It is our means by which we stand faultless before him. It's the means by which we have no condemnation. We have no shame, no guilt. Hallelujah. It is the means by which we've been made a new creation. It's the means by which we have this assurance and great confidence that has a great recompense of reward. And I can go on and on and on. And I don't want to repeat all of those things tonight, but because I want to just talk to you a little bit deeper about, you know, for example, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 26, Jesus said, Paul said, as often as you do this, you show the Lord's death until he comes. So the communion is about not only his death, but also his coming. And I guarantee you, Paul's not leaving out the resurrection. Okay? Because when we talk about death, we understand that through his death, he destroyed him that had the power of death. That through his death, he presented us faultless before the Father. You know, his death is the means by which that all iniquity and all the powers of darkness was destroyed. He abolished death through his death and brought life and immortality to light. And so once again, all that I know is review. And listen, for those of you who are interested in what we've been ministering on the past four nights about communion, it's on YouTube. And all you have to do is go back and all of the night services, none of the day service, but all the night services have been devoted to this. And I just want to talk to you about the table, because Jesus said in Matthew chapter, and correct me if I'm wrong, honey, Matthew chapter 26, and I believe it's verse 22 or 24. He said, I will not, when he was giving the cup, he said, I will not drink of the cup again until I drink it with you anew in my Father's kingdom. Ooh. And this is, and I want to talk to you a little bit about this tonight, you know. Verse 29, chapter Matthew 26, 29. I'm not going to drink the cup till I drink it anew with you in the kingdom. And he's really talking about the marriage supper of the Lamb. And I just want to talk to you a little bit about the marriage supper of the Lamb that is revealed in Revelation chapter 19 and verse 6 and Revelation 21, verse 5, I believe it is. But, you know, just want to talk, just focus on, you know, Revelation chapter 19, verses 6 and 7 and 8, I believe it would be. And so I kind of want to give you a little bit of background on this, okay? Are you ready? Yes. Can you just endure a little bit more with me? Can you? For me, I'm like happy, man. This is who I am. This is what I do. I'm Zoran right now, you know. Prakataya. And so, you know, I just hope you can enjoy the Word of God, because it's by the Word of God that, you know, we find our life in Him. His Word is living. All flesh is grass, all glory of men is a flower of the field. The grass withers and the flower thereof fades away, but the Word of God endures forever. And we've been born of the Word. Amen. And this is the Word which we now preach to you by the Holy Ghost. Amen. Hallelujah. Who was sent down to heaven, from heaven. An opportunity that each one of us have right now to be fully, to have the anointing of the Holy Ghost greater than Elijah had, greater than Enoch had, greater than Abraham had, greater than Moses had. Your opportunity right now, and all you got to be doing, all you got to do is be willing to cooperate with God in the most simple ways that he's presented before us. So I want you to look with me quickly in Genesis chapter 18. It will if you would make a study of Genesis chapter 18, it would change your whole theology about God. It would change your whole theology about God. You'd change your whole theology about the things that you believe about God, because that's what Genesis chapter 18 does. Most of the things that people believe about God came from Aristotle, not from Jesus. Most of the things that people believe about God came from Socrates and Philo, not from the Apostle Paul and Moses. Are you listening to me? Because they had a very different definition of God. Modern theology was actually shaped in the 3rd and 4th century by the marriage of Greekism, or what we call Hellenism, with the Scripture. And so from that, now you believe all these concepts about God. But when you start reading Genesis chapter 18, it starts blowing it out of the water, because here God shows up, and here he is. He's a body, and he's a person, and he can be seen. Somebody said, well, what about the Scripture says no man has seen God at any time? Well, you know, if you're going to make a big doctrine out of one verse of Scripture, you ought to go and read the Greek language and understand how many different ways it could be understood. No one has ever comprehended or understood God at any time, because many people have seen him, period. And there's no contradictions in the Bible, period. There's no contradictions in the Bible. And if you think you found one, then you know what? You're going to have to go back to the drawing board, because, you know, God hasn't made a mistake. But Genesis chapter 18, by the way, is not the first time that God was seen. Are you with me? Yeah. And the Scripture says that Yehovah appeared unto Abraham in the plains of Mamre. Are you seeing? Do you see that? I know in your Bible it probably just says Lord, but that's actually his name. Yehovah is his name. Some people call it the Yod Heh Vav Heh, or the Yahweh, but we really believe that his name is pronounced Yehovah. The most ancient pronunciation is Yehovah, Yehovah, but we say Yehovah. And so it's very close where it's Yehovah or Yehovah. That's what we say. But nonetheless, it's the Hebrew word Yehovah. That is who the name we have for Father appeared to Abraham. And what did Abraham do? He said, come over here and sit down. Let me get some water to wash your feet. Oops. We're changing right now here. Feet. Wash. Somebody said, well, wait a minute. But Moses, when Moses saw him in Exodus chapter 34, and I'm going to talk about that too, because I'm going to talk about the communion of Exodus, the communion table of Exodus, which is actually Exodus 26, or is it 24? But we'll get there in a minute. I'll know when I get there. At any rate, Abraham made a request, Father. He said, I want to see you in your unveiled glory. He said, I want to see you in all the fullness of your glory. Okay? Now, at that point in time, Father says to Moses, you can't. You can't see me in my full unveiled fullness of my glory. You can't see me in my eternalness. You'll die. He said, I don't care. Basically, what he said is, I don't care. He said, I want to. So that's another way of saying, I don't care. And Father says, well, okay. I'll have mercy on those whom I have mercy, and to those whom I give compassion, I'll show it. And so he said, okay, I'm a light up here. You know, when Jesus was talking to the Father, Mount Transfiguration, hallelujah, which is that word that is used for us about not being conformed to this world, but being transfigured by thinking different about ourselves. Back to Romans chapter 12, verse 2 again. Huh? That transfiguration. He began to shine with the brightness of the sun, eh? His clothes even began to shine. Your clothes got more light to it than you realize. Are you with me? Presence of God, everything starts lighting up. And so Father says, no, you can't see me in fullness of my glory, but I'll tell you what, I'm going to make a place for you to hide your face, and I'm going to put my hand over you to block all the radiation. Because that's what it is. It's radiation. It's radiant, the radiant glory of God. And he says, what you can do is when I pass by you, I will declare my name. Whew. What's going to happen? If I'm not careful, I'm going to start preaching another sermon. I'm going to declare my name. I'm going to shout out my name. I'm going to shout out who I am. And then you can look and you can see just my back parts. You can see me from behind. And so he could see him from the loins up as a man. Come on. Who you think you were shaped after the image and the likeness of anyways? I don't know why people have such a hard time with God's revelation of who he is instead of Aristotle's revelation of who he is. I don't see how people want to float over to Socrates and Plato when we got Paul and we got Jesus and we got Moses. Come on, you're with me. Hallelujah. But at any rate, and from my loins downward is a man. And just looking at the backside of Father, his face shined with a glory glow. Okay, so come on. So
What is the difference between what Abraham saw in Genesis chapter 18 and what Moses saw in Exodus 34? Moses simply asked to see his unlimited, glorious, eternal, radiating who he is in all fullness of his glory. Are you with me?
Yeah.
And Abraham didn't even ask. God just showed up and he's like, Sarah, quickly, make some bread. See, that didn't begin lately. It's been around for a while, long time. Women make better bread than guys, so don't be offended. Okay. It's women's work. Feminist, it's women's work. Somebody's dialing 911. Make bread. So the Lord made a woman the keeper of the house, the one who raises and nurtures the children. What's wrong with that? That's beautiful.
Yeah.
What's wrong with that? You know, they'd be out there with a shovel and a pickaxe lifting rocks. Huh? Out there basically fighting off the bears, trying to get yourself some meat for the table. You didn't have to be out there behind the plow, being pulled by the ox or by the horse, you know, until you're basically sweating to the point. And then, that you're about to collapse and faint. Women's work is a great work. Huh? It's like, I mean, you want to trade jobs?
Yeah.
I'm trying my best to stay on topic here. Hopefully it's not too late for me to continue on. Look at that. Make some bread. Kill a calf. Get a calf. Tender meat. Kill a calf. And he goes and he washes Papa's feet, Yehovah's feet. Make some bread. Get some water for them to drink. The other two that are with them are also, we can speculate. Hallelujah. And they're more than angels. I can prove that, but I'm not going to even go there right now because I know that I'm already in deep water for some people watching me by the web right now. They're like, what? You got to be kidding me. Genesis chapter 18 isn't literal. It's a metaphor. It's a simile. No, it literally happened. This really literally happened. Just as real as Isaac was born, this literally happened. That's because this is the announcement for Isaac. Hallelujah. It's not a simile. He came. Hallelujah. Papa got his feet washed. He got some bread. He got some water. He got some beefsteak. Hallelujah. Young calf. He sat underneath the shade and comforted himself and refreshed himself. Then he talked out with Abraham what he was about to do. Him and Abraham walked over to a place where they could look over Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities of the plain. And he says, should I hide from Abraham, seeing he's my friend, the thing that I'm about to do? And that's where Abraham bargained with Father. He said, says to him, should not the judge of all the earth do that which is right? We know by address after address after address after address who God, that this is God Almighty, God Yehovah. And there they sit down and they had a communion. And it was really centered around the covenant. And there was already a feast before this, but this really highlights a communion feast. Now, I want you to go and I want you to look when God called up, he called up Moses, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and 70 elders to come have some communion with him. And it was the ratification. This is real communion, really. It was the ratification of the new covenant. Somebody help me find it. I believe it's Exodus chapter 24. Isn't it Exodus chapter 24? And it would be Kitolo Mosikanda Rabasiki Tiarama Asheke Namaste Tibi Ataloboka. Verse 9. Hallelujah. Whew. That's a good words of knowledge there. You know what I'm saying? Just to get it right out of heaven. Katanamache Kanamea. Hallelujah. And what the Lord did was, he invited them all up. Hallelujah. And he took the blood. Moses took the blood, according to the word of the Lord, and he sprinkled the people and said, this is the covenant that I enjoin unto you. So this is the first covenant. No covenant is established without or ratified without the blood. And this is the first covenant that God gives
to man so that he now may begin to live in their midst and begin to deal with the whole community of people, because we know that death reigned from Adam unto Moses, right? So something happened. There wasn't an absolute sovereign reign anymore. It was interrupted by this family that God had brought together out of Abraham. Hallelujah. Toporo sate dekina. Hallelujah. And here they are, and they're sitting on the mount, right? And now I personally believe that what Moses did was he sprinkled all the people, the representatives, the 70 elders, because how many millions of people are there right now? That's a whole lot of blood. I'm not saying he couldn't get around to everybody. I'm just going to go ahead and is this a moment in time where I'm actually offering an interpretation? Yes, it is. Is my interpretation actually absolutely correct? No. Are you with me?
Yes.
But sprinkling over several million people with blood is a challenge. So I'm looking at this event as being the elders representing all the people, because they did it over and again. So he sprinkled them with the blood, right? And Papa says, come over here and sit down and eat with me. Pretty cool, huh? Let me read that. Is everybody looking at it?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Because Jesus does something similar to this for us, of course. And I like to look at communion as a time where we're eating with the Lord. Because it is. We are. We're celebrating. We're eating his, he's given us, his flesh is meat indeed, his blood is drink indeed. I mean, come on, he's the center of the table. Are you with me?
Amen.
Hallelujah. And it's a love feast. I mean, that's why when I have communion, I'm overwhelmed by the love of God. I'm going to tell you right now, if you can imagine this, I have been more taken by love than joy, and I've been pretty hysterical with the joy. There's been times I didn't know whether I was laughing or crying. Huh? There's been times where joy wouldn't stop, you know, and it was good. I mean, it's just, my face, my jaw, my muscles in my face started hurting as smile was so big for so long. But there's love. Love can overwhelm you in the same kind of way. You know, I've been actually slain under the presence of God. Call it slain, okay? Knocked out under the presence of God. And there's such an overwhelming magnitude of peace, I could not move. I didn't even blink. Just bathed in peace. I love those things, man. One of the great things I love about miracles is the dimension of compassion that I always experience when I function in the gift of miracles. It's one of the beautiful things about it. And there's just all, I love the manifest presence of God. I love the surging of his presence and his glory. See, Father alone has access to emotions that you and I can't ever get to. You know, you can be sad and upset a little bit, and some comedian comes along and tells a joke, and you start laughing. Because they accessed something that you couldn't, right? But it was shallow, right? It was purely human. It was in the realms of human thinking and human thought. Huh? Talk about a cat getting thrown out of the third story of a building and, you know, a few other things, but nonetheless. And you start laughing about it. But God, the Holy Ghost, comes and goes deep within our emotions and begins to produce a joy unspeakable. And nobody said nothing. Huh? And begins to go into the depths of our emotion and begins to produce an overwhelming love that it has, you know, and it has no visible source of that, an overwhelming peace. We want that. You can't have that until you learn how to cooperate with God. And a lot of it is, a lot of the things is just not allowing anything other than the hunger and thirst and just a wide open heart for the things of heaven. Because Satan will try to create suspicions and divisions and all these other things contrary to the word of God to keep you from ever being able to be available to receive what God has, just distracting you. And so that's why it's so important for us to understand how to just go with Father and understand that it's his word that trains us how. Hallelujah. Move with the Holy Ghost, and it's hunger and thirsting and desperation for more of him that begins to make the adjustments in our life. Just simple obedience. Simple obedience. You know, Paul said, don't let any man think more highly of himself than he ought, but let every man be sober and think of himself concerning after the manner of measure of grace that has been given in him. You know what scriptures I'm talking about, because I've been referring to Romans chapter 12 all night. But at any rate, Romans chapter 12 just been on me here, I guess. So at any rate, then you go over there and you read in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, discover how you can get all grace. Hello? So those things, are you listening to me? I didn't discover how I get all the grace, but I'm going to have to obey. I'm going to have to learn how to give with total abandonment. Amen? I'm going to have to give like the woman who gave all she had. All she had was two mites. Same as 2 million or 2 trillion. She gave all that she had. Same heart. Same heart. Hallelujah. And then he said, I cause all grace to abound in you, unto you, that you have all sufficiency in all things. And people stand at the crossroads all the time going, what I want? All grace or my bank account? All grace or my money? All grace are the things that I plan on buying for myself. Oh, yeah. God's looking for total abandonment. You want more of him? Huh? You're going to have to learn how to be emptied of yourself. And there's a lot of various different things that the Word of God tells us to do, and in obedience to them causes our spirits to be adjusted, because it's an emptying. It's an emptying. Hallelujah. It's an emptying. Huh? Catherine Kuhlman gave us a secret in the anointing that she... Well, baby, I'm making a mess. She gave us a secret to the things of flowing in the anointing. She said, God's not looking for golden vessels. He's not looking for silver vessels. He's looking for empty vessels. It's beautiful to look at everything out there in life and there's no attachment to it. You can easily give it all away. I've watched the people, I've been privileged to stand and watch many of the people who God's used in amazing ways. They had no attachment to anything. I was with a friend of mine one night and some nobility people in a country gave him a ring. It was a ring. It was an heirloom ring of nobility and royalty. It was some of the royal jewels of that nation. And I was so blessed that he had that. I just felt he needed to have that. And then all of a sudden it got placed in a meeting. I knew he was going to give it to the preacher. And I'm like, don't give him that ring. But he has... What was part of his anointing was he has no attachment to any earthly thing. It means nothing. No attachment. Because all of his attachments and all of his desires in heaven, the car, the truck, the house, the ring, the jewelry, everything. No attachment. See, many of you have attachment stuff you don't even know. You haven't dealt with it. And only obedience to the Word of God. I can't get off that. I'm trying to go over here and talk about supper. See, I can't even get off of it. I can't ever get off the point of what God the Holy Ghost wants me to speak. No matter how hard I try, I can get in a cute few verses. Huh? Are you with me?
Yes.
You just have to ask yourself, are you willing to have an exchange, your life for his? Amen. Are you willing no longer to live in yourself, but to live his life? He's got far more for you than what you can ever get for yourself or ever have for yourself. But you've got to let go of all your stuff. Have all that he has for you. That's the fundamentals of the gospel. We're crucified with Christ. Not being crucified. You ever people talk about being crucified? Huh? We're all dying. We're not dying. You say we're supposed to die daily? That's not what Paul said. He said, I protest that you're rejoicing. I die daily. And he was talking about his body going, physical body going to the grave. But that's not what Jesus said. And he wasn't talking about I die daily or I'm being crucified daily. Because you can't get a resurrection until you die. And God wants you to be raised up together with me. Huh? There's no resurrection until you die. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Does that make sense? Does that make good sense?
Yes.
Amen? So he tells us to do something far harder. He says, deny yourself. Huh? Deny yourself daily. That's what Jesus calls us to do daily. And he says us in being able to have the privilege of even doing it, he says the only reason we get to do this is because we're crucified with Christ. Say, I'm crucified with him.
I'm crucified.
Because that's what you're doing when you're taking the communion. You say you no longer live. It's Christ Jesus that lives. So many people don't want to take what God has given them. They feel like, well, I hope someday that I can say that for me to live as Christ. Well, that's the same as saying, someday I hope that my name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. That's the same as saying, someday I hope that I'm saved. Are you listening to me? You're going to be willing to embrace this unspeakable gift and take these treasures that God has given us, a free gift. Hello. Amen. Because until you believe, it's never a reality for your life. And I'm crucified with Christ. I'm buried with him by baptism into his death. I'm raised up together with him. I'm alive together with him. I'm seated with him in the heavenly realm.
Amen.
Come on, people. This is what we're doing when we take in the communion. Hallelujah. Isn't it wonderful that Thanksgiving is tomorrow? And we can have Thanksgiving night. How many of you celebrate Thanksgiving once a year? No. Everybody does. How many of you think celebrate Thanksgiving? Come on, it's not a trick question. How many of you celebrate Thanksgiving once a year? Yeah, okay, good. Everybody does. Now, how many of you celebrate Thanksgiving every day? And everybody should do that too. Everybody, I know you guys were just waiting. You thought it was a trick question. And you don't celebrate just once. Huh? If you say you're going to celebrate once. Okay. You didn't want to be wrong. Sure. Praise God for this. Praise God for the privilege of living in obedience to the Word. Understanding this is the will of God concerning you in Christ Jesus, that you always give thanks. But what if we don't do that? Then we're going to miss out on our opportunities to be everything the Father's purpose for us to be. And have the things that He wants to continually supply to us. Say, I'm crucified with Christ.
I'm crucified with Christ.
Say, I'm buried with Him by baptism into His death.
I'm buried with Him by baptism into His death.
Say, I'm raised up together with Him.
I'm raised up together with Him.
Say, I live together with Him.
I'm alive
together with
Him.
I'm seated with Him in the heavenly realm. Now, when that becomes more of a living reality because you're willing to give yourself to it, you don't have any affections of the things of this earth. You have no desires for anything. Your heart's not, you don't have any heartstrings for anything. So that you come into a place of the move of God where no man calls anything which he possesses his own. It's for him. It's Papa's. It's not mine. No attachments. One time I gave my wife this amazing ring. There's some things I've given to my wife. I said, do not give it away. I said that. Because, you know, I got this amazing gift for her. It was like, you know, one of the best things that I ever was able to get her. And the next thing I know, she's like giving it away. Sowing it in the offering or something. Somebody's getting it. And then it's going in the offering. And I said, baby, when you want to do that, please just let me know. Let me redeem it. And I will give the cash. Let me redeem it. Let me first have first option of redemption. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But that's the heart. That's the heart. I know that she, I know her heart strings are not attached to her ring. I mean, I was able to get my wife a great ring, but like 20 plus years after we were married, right? 17 years after we were married. Because what I got her when we were married, you had to have a microscope, not a magnifying glass. You had to have a microscope to see the diamond. You know, and it cost me $250, and I had to do payments to pay that off for like a year. You know, so. But I know her heart's not attached to it. I know it's in the kingdom. Come on, can you hear what I'm saying? The Word of God teaches us to do things in simple obedience to them. We step in to the realm of abilities to receive from God and begin to move with God in the true riches and the true blessings. So long as we hang on to our little trinkets, we never have the riches. People want the toys of the flesh rather than the treasures of the spirit. Huh? People want their own, the things what they provide for themselves rather than the abundance that God wants to give. All you got to do is prove the Lord. It's the one thing he says, prove me with, is in the realms of finances. People withhold. Listen to me. I'm going to tell you tonight, we're going to receive God's treasure here. His great gift. You listen to me. It is wrong to ever appear before the Lord without an offering. If you don't appear before the Lord if you appear before the Lord without an offering, it is a clear declaration in your heart that you never had any praise there either. Because reality of it's hooked together. Where your treasure is, there's your heart also. Did I bring my heart to the meeting? I'm bringing my treasure. And there have been many times we didn't have any finance. We didn't even have money to buy food. There's been times, even recently, we didn't have finances to buy food. There was nothing. We invested it all, gave it all. There's nothing. There's nothing to buy food. Where there was a little bit of money is offering time. Let's just give it an offering. And because what we find in that is we find a great release of provision from heaven. We found it over and again. Father's not a liar. Now, we do the same thing. There's many times people come and, now, we don't have enough money to finances to pay the bills. And yet,
And then, you know, we'll just take the receive the offering and add to it and just give, just bless. Because why? We've discovered in a great abundance. Amen. We live in like Jesus for others. We live in like Jesus for the kingdom. We live in like Jesus for the cause of the kingdom, for the cause of the Father's will. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Listen, we're going to partake of the riches of heaven poured out for you and me. He who is rich became poor for our sake, that through his poverty we might be made rich. So I need you guys to go help Elizabeth tonight. Just all of you go over there. All of you go over there and help. Joshua, you're on the music. I really wanted to talk to you about the supper of the Lamb, about the communion with the Father. But I'm talking to you things about that are more important for you. And, you know, when we talk about living by the Word, we're really talking about living by Jesus. And if you can just make that equation, if you can equate these realities, when you can all of a sudden recognize, when I'm reading the written Word, and I'm responding to the written Word, and I'm living by the written Word, and I hear God say something, and I respond. I'm responding to Jesus. I'm living by Him. I'm interacting with Him. We'll just listen. Sometimes people just, I watch people, they close up their heart to God. Why? Because God says something and they don't do it. They don't respond. It's closing up your heart. You can't practice closing up your heart and practice receiving, opening up your heart at the same time. Are you listening to me? You don't want to practice closing your heart off to God. You want to just practice opening your heart to God. You don't want to practice saying no, resisting, I don't agree, I don't believe that, I can't do that. You want to practice the opposite, because the more you give yourself to opening the Lord heart to the Lord, the wider your heart becomes. The more you give yourself to quick obedience, the more that you're able to receive from the Lord, walk on the water, raise the dead, do these signs, do these wonders, speak this word. I've had the most radical words of knowledge that God's ever spoken to, through me, by just simply one word, just one word, or one image given to me by the Lord. Just see something, an image. And then just simply quick to respond, not to rationalize, not to try to think it through. And you know, what happens is people get in this place and they want to just tell everybody about how great and wonderful God is, and that's good, but you need to learn how great and wonderful God is.
Yes.
Huh? You want to tell about people about radical obedience. You need to learn about radical obedience. Huh? Hallelujah. You need to learn how to live your life out as just an offering to the Lord. Just a continual act of obedience. Continual living sacrifice. We're going to have the sacrifice tonight. And in having the sacrifice, we're enjoining ourselves in Him that we're a living sacrifice. We're saying that we thus judge that if one died for all, then all are dead. I'm dead. I don't live to myself anymore. I live in Him. That means everything I have is His. One amen. Two amens now. Three nodded heads. One hand raised. Because it's just reality of it is. It's not right there. The more it becomes right there, the more powerful the response. Understand this. As you live out the word, the more powerful the response. Listen, it's just the way it is. It's a psychological thing. It just, what's really going on inside of you, there's certain things that can be done to really bring out what you're really thinking, what you really believe, where you're really at. Circumstances bring that. God's trying you. God will try you, your heart. He will evaluate you. He will bring you to situations over and over again. See what you're going to do. I wouldn't always find myself giving, obedient, submitted, bowing. I'll do it. Yes, Lord. There's only one important phrase that you need to know in your relationship with the Lord. Yes, Lord. Just yes. If I'm in a meeting and the preacher says bring an offering and I don't have something, I'm going to find something. I'll take my shoes off. Whatever. I won't take my shirt off. That'd be inappropriate. I'm going to find something. Huh? Are you with me? Anybody ever borrowed money from someone in the meeting? Yeah, you got to. Preacher says, that's good. Look, I don't have any finances. I just had to do it the other night. I had to borrow from Kay. Kay, did I pay you back? Pay Kate back. I mean, if we haven't paid Kate back, then we didn't give an offering. I went. There was offering time. I was ministering. And there was offering time. No, I wasn't ministering that night. No, somebody else was ministering. Good. Okay, good. It was offering time. And I'm like, where's the money? Honey, where's the money? She's like, and I'm like, yeah. Cade, you got any money? Yeah. How much money did I borrow from you? I borrowed some money. Who did I borrow from? I borrowed from someone. I paid him back. If you're watching right now and I didn't pay you back. I'm just making a point. It's an important point. I want to just be so yielded. See, we can sit here tonight and we can say, I just want to be so yielded to you. Lord, I want to know how to move. I want to know how to flow. And he's going to tell you, obey me. Respond to my word. When I'm speaking it directly to you from the word, or when I'm speaking it to you from my servant, respond. Lord, I'll go with you when you're speaking with the word, but I don't know if I'm going to go with you. You're speaking from your servant. Well, then you have no supply. Listen, communion is about a connection. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 16 tells us about a connection. It says, because God has called us to grow up into Christ Jesus, the head into all things, who supplies to every part of the body, who you and I are members in particular of, referred to as joints and bands or ligaments and connective tissue, so that we may then supply. If you're connected to Him, if we're connected to Him, we're going to supply to each other, because we're receiving the supply, we're going to supply to each other. And then the body, then the church, the body of Christ, builds itself up and grows because it edifies itself in the supply. This love supply. Huh? Oh Lord, I just thank you that you did all this for me, but I really don't have time to do anything for anybody else. Connection is not right. You're not going to grow. You're not going to mature. You're not going to grow up into Him into all things. Because you're not willing to go. Huh? You're willing to receive, but you're not willing to give. Every dimension of our life, the word is calling us to live, be a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable. Amen. Hallelujah. It's not forced obedience. It's not a forced sacrifice. I'm just telling you. I hurt for people sometimes. I really do. I hurt for them in the depths of my being. They're never going to get it. They're going to always feel like a failure. They're going to always feel like that they're left out. They're always going to feel like they're coming up short. Because over and again, they disobey. And then I want to get in their face and say, I want to poke them on their chest and say, you're disobeying right now. But I can't do that. The only Lord won't allow me. But you wouldn't forget that if I start. Are you with me? I said, no. Leave him alone. It's got to come from the heart. You got to be moved. At some point in time, we so fall in love with the living word that the written word becomes equally loved. We're so in love with the living word, we recognize that the written word is what he's saying. We so fall in love with the living word, Christ Jesus, that we recognize that those whom he has anointed are speaking out his word. If I tell you to go and do something, it just always happens that way. But nonetheless, if I go and tell you to do something that's not written in the Word, don't do it. Unless you're convinced the Spirit of the Lord is speaking. And that's going to take another level of trust. Because God told Abraham, go sacrifice your son. I mean, I've told people to do certain things that was almost on the same level of go dip 7 times in the Jordan. Go wash in the pool of Siloam. I've told people some strange things. And there's some people who's like, What? That's weird, man. I'm not doing that. That's weird. It's flaky. There's other people that are going to do it, and the miracle happened. Where's your response in this? Where's your level? First of all, first cut, just obey the word. When I say something and it's clear in the word of God, you want to jump up and do it. You want to run. You want to run. You want to quickly do it. That's two hands for beginners. Then let God's spirit of the word speak to you. Because we're not here to give people direction. We're here to confirm the direction. Holy Ghost wants to direct you. He wants to speak directly to you. But you're never going to hear his direct word speaking to you. You're not going to be sensitive to it until you are obedient to the word that is written every time. You listen to me. The more you're quick to obey the word of God that is written, your heart becomes trained to hear his voice. It's a communion. It's a fellowship around the word. The living word. We're going to have the word for bread. We're going to have the word for drink. This section here, would you stand up? Come over. Let every man examine himself before he eats. The examination is simply this. I'm going to dwell in him. I want my whole life to exist by him.
Love you.
Baby, what happened to my sweet hair? What happened to my beautiful hair? I love you. You're still beautiful. We just have to let it grow back out quick. Oh, Lord Jesus. Love you. Love you, Brad. Bless you, man. Love you. Bless you. Josh, love you, buddy. Shikona Masatena Mayala. We got plenty of tortillas here. Just this? This is it? Ooh, gonna have to be sparing. Where are they at? Where? Okay, so you can get them if I run out. How are you doing? It's good. Sikon bando raboshe nam badanaya. Sikondo raboshikane miyatea poya. Shikande rapasana nea palanaya. Hasiterite. Hasiterite. Hasiterite namoshta. Hasrinande. Haranamande. Hallelujah. Say obedience.
Obedience.
Say submission.
Submission.
Shibaramangade. Somebody said, how many different folks do women have to submit to? Then somebody says, how many different folks does men have to submit to? It very much equals out. Husbands, hey, husbands, obey your wives. Now, if I said that to you tonight and I commanded you, I said, husbands, obey your wives. You wouldn't have to believe that. You wouldn't have to obey that, would you? So don't look at me too strange, because I'm going to say, wives, obey your husbands. Now, you can look at me just as strange as you want now. Are you listening to me? Huh? You better do it. You better do it. Husbands, or where I'll go to this, I'll just say right now. Wives, obey your husbands after you've argued with them for 2 days. Well, how is it that you do it? Because I'm getting at the word of God. I'm getting at how you're going to be yielded to the Holy Ghost. But wives, obey your husband after you've thoroughly shook him down. Hey? We're talking about if you want to be submitted to the Holy Ghost, if you want to be connected, you're going to have to obey God's word. Here you go, buddy.
Mark.
Hey, buddy, how you doing?
How's it going?
Good, good. Bless you, man.
Glad you're here. Thank you. Bless you. Here, no, take, here. Here you go, give me this. How are you? Bless you, sweetie. Let me ask you, do you know what that is? What that represents? Okay, well, you've got to understand what it represents. First of all, have you asked Jesus to come into your life? Have you turned your whole life over to Jesus? You live for him? You do? You've asked Jesus to come in your heart. Change you. Okay. The bread represents his body. Because his body is the means by which we find our salvation. Let me tell you how that works, okay? He went to the cross of Calvary 2,000 years ago. And in his own body, he took all of our sins. He took all of your sins. He took all my sins. And his body was there on the cross, crucified and destroyed, because the wages of sin is death. So that he could offer to us his body as a means that we can now be forgiven of sin and die with him. So when we talk about taking his body, his death, that which represents his death, we're talking about being crucified together with him. That we no longer live, it's Jesus that lives. We talk about living by his life that he gave for us. Now we don't live according to our own fashion, our own thinking, our own ideas, our own way of living, the way that everybody else in our community lives or whatever, or school, but we live just like Jesus. So that's what this represents, that we're living by him, because his body was the means by which our sins was taken away. Okay? And you believe all of that? And you agree with all of that? That's good. Where you go to church at?
By our house.
Huh? Right by your house? Who did you come with? Came with Bobby. And what's your name?
Lucia.
Lucia. Father, I ask you to touch Lucia right now. Yes. That everything about living for you, about letting your life be fully realized in her life, will become a reality tonight in the name of Jesus. Okay? Yeah, you take one of those. So when you bring people to communion, you make sure that you go through these things with them. Because no one can, if you eat and drink the blood and the body unworthily, you eat and drink damnation to your soul. So nobody wants to bring somebody to church to destroy them, right? You bring people to church on a communion, you want to make sure that you spend some time talking with them about it, right? Yes. Amen. Okay, good. And so, you know what this represents, right? What does it represent?
Body.
The body of Jesus. Good. Good. Bless you, dear. Understand that it wasn't that many years ago that no one would serve, a pastor or minister would not serve communion to anyone that first was not clearly a member of the church and was not also examined to prove that they truly had completely turned over their life to Jesus and totally consecrated their entire life to him. And then the communion was served recognizing that I am crucified with Christ, because the communion represents that I no longer live. It's Christ Jesus that lives. I live by him. I live by his body and by his blood. Understand this. Understand this. I'm afraid we've drifted far from what the foundation of the church really is about. This is very holy. It's very sacred. This is not snacks. Okay? Very important. It's very sacred. Amen? Bless you, dear. Love you, man. Bless you. Bless you, dear. Bless you. Love you. This section. Bless you. Love you. You doing good? You happy?
Yes.
Good. Boys, how are you doing tonight? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Bless you, my dear brother. Bless you.
Thank you very much.
Bless you, my dear brother. Bless you. Hallelujah. Bless you, my dear brother. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Borastan the Mecca Yishtaber. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Phew. Thank you, Living God. Love you, dear. Love you, dear. Hey, how are you doing? Good to see you. How are you? It's good to see you. Bless you. Hey, baby. Good to see you, man. Bless you. Love you, dear. Thank you, Jesus, for the anointing. Thank you, Jesus, for the Holy Ghost.
The Holy Ghost.
Urababasate. Harabanda kiyayala. Good to see you. Love you too. Ishibremandish tekira. Hallelujah. Brain and a mosande rebeke. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Blessed is your holy name, Lord.
Thank you, blessed Lord.
Sevri numan sekeri di biata andere di kiste. Anda andere deste. How you doing, buddy? Ishi porumaka andere di se pronose. Bless you, dear. It's good to see you tonight.
Yes.
Love you too. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he lifted it up towards heaven and he blessed it. And he said, "This is my body which is broken for you." I want every one of you to just agree with me right now. I want you to say this with me. Say, "Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
I thank you for your body.
It
was broken for me.
That was broken for me.
I receive everything that you've done.
I receive everything that you've done.
I thank you that you come to dwell on the inside of me.
I thank you that you come to dwell on the inside of me.
That you live in me.
That you live in me.
That I no longer live.
That I no longer live.
It's you that lives.
It's you that lives.
And I just consecrate myself right now.
And I just consecrate myself.
To live fully for you.
To live fully for you.
To draw all my nourishment, all my life from you, Lord Jesus.
Draw all my nourishment, all my life from you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
I thank you, Lord, that your body,
thank you, Lord, that your body
is the means by which I step into the holies of holies. Just as the veil was rent in two. So your body was broken. So that I could step in to the holies of holies. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
That death, that sin, that the power of darkness, that the power of Satan, that every dominion of hell was broken and destroyed by your body,
by your broken body,
by your death at Calvary.
I thank you, Lord Jesus,
that tonight, through the body of your flesh, I am now presented holy, unblameable, unreprovable. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Never forget how much this cost the Father. So many times I've stood there contemplating the scripture as the Father
demanded of Abraham to take Isaac and sacrifice him on the altar. And the commitment and the consecration that Abraham had to the Father to not even refuse that offering. And I've imagined myself taking Joshua or Daniel and ready to plunge the knife into their throat, into their heart. Father didn't make Abraham go that far, but Father did go that far. When he sacrificed Jesus at Calvary for you and me. Never forget the offering. Never forget the cost. The price that was paid so that you could be here. He wouldn't talk about the price that was paid so that we could be a nation and we can have our freedom. So now even though we're comparable to the price that was paid, that we may have the spiritual freedom, that we may have this life in God, in Christ Jesus. Always live in the gratefulness of it. Always live in the thanksgiving of it. Always live in the beauty of it. Because it will cause you to become the most giving person. Recognize that because he gave his life, you and I have the privilege of giving our life with him. Hear this. The wages of sin is death. Listen to me. That means that you have to pay for your sin through death. That's God's law. Jesus was made a sacrifice so that he could bear our sins in his own body so that you and I could be crucified together with him. Not just watch him be crucified and say, okay, we're off the hook. No. When we take of the bread and the communion, we're saying, I'm crucified together with you. I live by you. You're not just my substitute offering. I am crucified together with you. I no longer live. This is the consecration of the communion. This is the communion. This is how we have communion. In other words, fellowship with him. This is about fellowship with him. This is the token and really just meditating on and thinking about and understanding and partaking of what he did through his death and how that we died with him. We died with him. We're dead. We no longer live. The more you'll begin to consecrate yourself to that, accept that, love God, the Holy Ghost to reveal that to you. Come on. The more you get to partake of the communion, the more you get to partake of the fellowship, the more you get to partake of the unlimited blessings, the more you get to mature in all that he's given for us, given to us, done for us. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your blood. Listen, people, tonight when we take a hold of the cup, Jesus said, this is the new covenant in my blood. It's been sprinkled upon us. It ratifies the covenant. It is the testimony that our sins and our iniquities are remembered no more. Don't try to remember any of them. It is the recognition that our spiritual garments have been washed whiter than snow. It is the recognition that every stain of sin has been removed. That he's loosed us or washed us from our sins in his own blood. That his blood cleanses us from all unrighteousness. The removal of sin, the removal of unrighteousness, the removal of iniquity. It's all here in the new covenant. The new covenant is the ratification of union with him. The new covenant. When Paul had the reality of the new covenant revealed to him, he understood that Christ, the Father had purposed that his Son, Christ Jesus, be revealed in him. The new covenant. Don't think of the new covenant in a limited way. Understand it. The new birth experience, the born again experience, the divine nature, Christ in you, the hope of glory, Christ Jesus being revealed through you. All of this by means of his blood, his life-giving power flowing into us. Amen. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the new covenant. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's something I want to point out to you tonight. And that is that tonight we had communion as far as the elements are concerned without any leaven. There is no leaven in the bread and there's no leaven in the cup. If it was wine or if it was alcohol, it would be leavened. See, the Passover set the table for the new covenant communion to take place. The Passover, Jesus Christ is our Passover, and 1 Corinthians chapter 5 says that we're to keep the Passover with no leaven. And so Paul didn't united the communion table with the Passover. And if you go back and you read in Exodus chapter 12, you'll find out that he who takes of the Passover with leaven will be cut off. In fact, there was such a ritual of making sure there was no leaven in the house before Passover began. You hear me? And I'm just talking, what does leaven represent? Represents sin. Somebody say, well, how was wine made back then? I don't care how wine was made back then. I know how it's made now. It's got to be, leaven has to be used. Yeast has to be used. And so, it's a symbolism to us of, once again, that we're in this celebration, in this communion with the Lord, in which all the sin and iniquity has been removed. It doesn't exist anymore. Don't let it exist. I promise you, dear people, that we're ministering things to you right now that you want to begin to live, that you may be presented before his throne. Amen. With exceeding joy, faultless, with great boldness. But you just live this out, because all that's going to matter throughout the ages to come, we're on our way. I was going to talk to you about heaven tonight. What do I believe heaven is? What does the marriage supper of the Lamb look like? I believe heaven is like the Garden of Eden, but with all the company of saints gathered around Christ Jesus. The things I want to describe, I'm not going to go into it tonight. The things that are in my heart to describe about what the marriage supper of the Lamb looks like, and what that communion is like, and the price that was paid for you and I to be here and to be there demands a complete surrender of everything that we are and everything that we have to him. All that I am, all that I have, and all that I will ever be, could not repay the love and debt that I owe. Oh God, I surrender to thee. That's got to be our response. We can't hold any of ourselves back. And when we have communion, we're saying, Lord, I'm crucified with you. I'm buried with you by baptism in your death. I'm raised up together with you. I'm alive together with you. You hear me? When you bring people to church, I want to make sure, and I'm sure that every one of you do, especially when we have communion, just walk them through salvation. Make sure that they've accepted Jesus into their life. Lay hands on them, pray for them, help them understand, because we're not going to refuse anybody communion. I'm not going to refuse anybody communion. I mean, the Lord would have to just shake me before I would ever refuse someone communion, but I'm going to make sure they know what they're doing. And I want to make sure you know what you're doing. I want to make sure that you know that you're living this out on a daily basis. This is actually just a symbol of what we're living out on a daily basis, and I want you to get it. I want you to get what the ratification of the covenant is all about, because it takes two people to enter into a covenant. One person doesn't enter into a covenant, you know. There's no such thing. It takes two to enter into a covenant. This is what the Lord's done for us, and then in turn, this is what he says we are to him. We dwell in him. We live by him. Come on, people. Hold no part of yourself back from him. The benefits are too good. The exchange. Above all that we could think or ask. He who knew no sin. Listen to me. He who knew no sin became the sin offering. That's what we're taking up tonight. The sin offering. That we might be made the righteousness of God. What we're saying is, I'm the righteousness of God. I've got no sin. I've been cleansed. All unrighteousness, all iniquity been removed. I'm holy and unblameable and unrebukable before him. I mean, I've gone through these things. I've gone through host of scriptures over the past four nights that we've had covenant, the covenant meal. And I don't know. I feel like I should do it for a year. Just continually do it. Because this is the heart of it all. It's the heart of salvation. Yeah. Everybody stand with me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. People, I'm gonna let you understand something that I believe with all my heart. I want you to hear this. I believe we have to be very strict with ourselves. I believe if we really love people around us, we're going to be very strict with them on how they behave and what they do and how they respond to the things of God as they're learning to count them sacred. And I pray that you, everyone in this place tonight, that you gladly submit yourself to the rule of Jesus Christ. That you gladly submit yourself to the rule of the Spirit of God. That you gladly submit yourself to the rule of His Word. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We'll find a bunch of people and hug them and tell them that you love them and bless them in Jesus' name. And come worship the Lord with your offerings. Bless His holy name. Just give of yourself. Give of yourself in every way. Don't hold anything back. Bring an offering in righteousness. Amen.